time I got back on the room, was like, got the red button nailed, even practice. It works perfectly.
That's all we need.
It's the surveyors will have a problem.
Have we? Hard to show like the stuff on the tablet happening.
Up on live.
Yeah. And I'll just touch that thing there. How did you get out of this, Alistair? Oh yeah? It's on?
I thought we were on.
I knew they'd just turn it on to me when I wasn't ready.
I think I'm on too.
Good. You can probably turn yourself off if you want. You don't want to break it. Fair enough. What have we got? 12:30. Time to kick off.
Yep.
Good afternoon, everybody. Well, welcome to the fun room, I think. That's what we should call it, isn't it? Let those drainage people have those bits. And the surveyors who know what they do. So yes, we're in the Birds of the Feather design first session. My name is Rod Burns and Joel Allsop is my trusted associate. He'll be taking the second half. We're gonna go through some of the parts of the MTF file, the modifiers. Gonna take it right back to the basics essentially to start off with. Because a lot of the other tools that Joel will go through and you'll probably see in some of the other design sessions in the room over the next couple of days, we'll also build on the MTF file and use some of the tricks that are in there as well. So we really wanted to just pair it right back, show you some of the other, maybe some of the modifiers you actually don't use that often or just some tricks that are in there. So I tried to get a whole lot of different examples together and show you some of the other bits and pieces that are in there. So what's required for any real civil design, you'd basically need these three bits of the jigsaw puzzle to get going. The triangulation, which is pretty straightforward, a super alignment, and either some templates or a snippet, and that would obviously produce all our design strings and links. The super alignment, don't know who many people are still using the IP method possibly, or the element method or the parametric design in there. I usually refer to that as a Lego box just because there's so many parts, and actually when you list them like that, it's actually quite scary of how many different parts there are in there, where people get lost in there sometimes. Always a good one for support. And then we really start back at the snippets where 12D started from and actually placing in the strings into the templates or the snippets themselves, actually producing up the cross-section of what you want for your design to look like, giving it the dimensions, the width and height, or the different elements in there to form those up. And essentially the snippets do exactly the same thing. There's a whole bunch of snippets that come directly with 12D, get shipped automatically, and they basically produce the same sort of idea, but obviously in terms of some of the organisations really like the snippets because it takes away the need to name the strings and pick colours and things like that, and it's a lot easier to standardise the snippets as well for an organisation. But essentially also like placing the strings in where one is linked off the other, and you'll see it in the panel as it comes up in the MTF file later, that basically our new string that we wish to produce down here will be linked back off a previous point. And I wish I had put the base point in there, really. It should say base point, because that's essentially where the previous point's coming from. And some of the other things we can do in terms of the layers and the models that actually insert points absolutely and not actually put them in the design cross-section at all, having them above or below the layers or basically wherever you want to create the strings themselves. So yes, we always started off with the design surface, but then when they started to introduce layers, the links can be basically wherever you want them to be. It's really up to you. So again, really going back to, because it's really hard to put a talk together when we don't know where people are along the design, how much design knowledge you've got. So I'm going right back. I don't know how many people still use the interface panel, possibly, or the apply template. Again, I've got a couple of little basins that I've prepared that use those, but most people would be straight into the apply MTF. And obviously it's the MTF file, the modifiers and templates file, that have all the commands in there to control the strings and really make the design do what you want it to do to form the outcome. So yeah, in the last conference, we went through all the smart changes. I'm not gonna go through any of those, and basically looked at some of the really simple modifiers that get used a lot, you know, placing in templates and things like that, inserting individual strings. And then obviously modifying the link, that's probably the biggest one that most people use when they're starting off with the modifiers and getting into design, to be able to modify the strings, change the height, width, and crossfall, and adjust the strings as needed. I wanted to get in and actually, also the tour string. I think that's also another one where you've got a CAD string or an element, and you want to go and match that horizontally and vertically. We also do that in the first couple of days of training with new users. So I'm not going to cover those ones. And obviously then we can also remove links out of an intersection and things as well. So, you know, I'm not going to go through those ones. I wanted to concentrate on some of the other ones. And so when you start to expand them out again, you sort of realize there are quite a number in there. So I'm just going to go through, starting off with some of the, just the general inserts. And essentially, it doesn't matter whether you insert it through directly into the MTF file or still use the templates, it's just producing the strings in the design or the final design road layer surface, or you can also insert them in other layers as well, and I'll get into that. So I'm not going to cover some of these because they have been done before, and we'll basically just kick off. So in the last conference, and there is a webinar on the 12D training webinars as well, that goes into the smart changes and looks at the widening and the tour string option. I went on the same project and designed it a little bit further, a bit of a subdivision, but it is a bit of a hodgepodge in terms of the design. It's not the best engineered design at all, because I tried to use as many of the modifiers as I could. So I'm just opening up the MTF file. Again, I tend to use the recalc panel to open up the MTF file in this reference string 03 or road number 3 that I've got there. And I just wanted to use some of the other insert options to show you how you can also insert strings, because there are quite a number of options in there. So again, just opening up the modifiers on the right side. Again, not going to go through too much with the regions or the comments that can you leave there, the individual yellow comments that you can leave in the MTF file for the next users. They're always a good idea. But you can see this road that I put together essentially just inserted all the strings individually. I didn't actually use a template at all or a snippet. I just inserted the strings directly into the modifiers themselves. So I wanted to come and have a look at this one, crossfall, intersect, inserting a new fall, nominating the two crossfalls that I'm interested in and getting them to intersect in space. So the idea was basically coming off the back of the boundary line there, and I've draped on a CAD control string, essentially along the back of the boundaries. Could be used to do things like lot grading. So going basically from your road, I guess your front fence line or the property boundary to the back property boundary, and you might want a 1% grade across the lot till it finds the back fence there, the construction tree. And I've just draped that onto the tin so it had some vertical geometry off the survey triangulation as well. So given that I've got that construction string at the back, I'm opening up the panel here, you can see this intersect, crossfall intersects, that's the new link I'm going to produce. And I basically told 12D to go and find that other constructed draped string at the back, that one there, and I've just nominated the two crossfalls that I want. So from the fence line at the front, or from my road, I want 1% back, and then basically a 10% crossfall up to the boundary line. And 12D will then go horizontally and vertically, go and work out where those two slopes would intersect in space. And that's the plan with this one. So it could be used for something like this. I thought this was sort of a good example to sort of show you might want to use it on. It's also used quite a bit for highway design, where the guys have got, you know, independent carriageways and they're trying to find the depressed median. Obviously the carriageways are moving apart and horizontally and vertically, and it will find then where the depressed median string needs to be. So I'll just move some of these panels out of the way so I can quickly show you a cross section, and you'll see how, the string that's been produced. Just profile that there. Hopefully you can see there, it's basically gone from the road basically at 1% all the way back to created my new string. And then I've still got that little cyan dot on the screen there. Hopefully you can see that. That is the draped construction string that I placed in there. So yeah, 12D's essentially found where those two strings would meet in space. So I'm just running through the video. So obviously talking quicker than the video is running. Obviously, you do have to be a little bit careful with the values you placed in there. Obviously, 1%, that made sense, and the 10%. But you might also be thinking, actually, I want it to go down at 10%, basically, or grade down to find where that intersection point is. So you might just have to be a bit wary of the numbers that you place in there. If I was to put a negative in there, and you can see I run it again and process that again, it will, again, obviously insert the string, but it's actually gone past the point because it actually is still going through the CAD draped string, but it's actually grading down at 10% on a slope down rather than a positive up through that string. So you just have to be aware of your crossfall numbers that you're placing there, because you might just get a result that you really weren't expecting. So that's how that one works. So I'll just set that back and hit apply. Move on to one of the other commands there, which is insert. And this is not just a straight insert. It's actually insert add a string, and essentially allows you to place, or again, create a new string in as part of your design, but add another selected string. So an external string, so something that the surveyor might have given you, or that might have come out of somewhere else that has horizontal and vertical geometry, and 12D will go and then match that string. And that then clearly shows you that, yes, it's going up at the 10% that I asked for from the previous command. So it's produced that string on top of where that draped cadastral construction string was. Peter, or some of the 12D snippets actually use that. There's a recreate MTF option in there. I don't know whether you've seen that under design, design apply MTF recreate, where we can actually recreate the design strings. So if you do have strings coming out of another package, we can basically run a tool and recreate an MTF file and inserts. All it does is essentially goes through and does lots of little inserts and inserts them string upon string upon string again. The third one I wanted to show you with the inserts is inserting it around an arc. You would have seen this before when Lee's presentation was about actually creating it for tunnels and things. So I've just placed a whole lot of links in there, 10 strings to create, given it the width, height, and the radius that I want it to produce. And you can see as I run this one and apply it, it'll create a curve for me. Now all the vertices are exactly on the arc, and essentially it's just quartered between the arc, around the arc. It's 2 times exaggerated, so I'll just quit that back to 1. And you can see all those vertices are then placed around a curve, a true curve. Obviously, the more links you have in there, the shorter the chord's going to be. And again, you will have to be just a little bit careful about the way that the radius is formed. So with a positive radius, you can see the way it turns to the right. And if you place a negative radius, you can pretty well guess what a negative radius will do, go the other way. So I don't know that it's a very good thing to have in a subdivision. Well, you might have a different use for that I can't really think of, but that you can sort of see its applications for tunneling and how the guys can quickly place those strings in there for the tunneling. And then using some of the other create strings options and modifying the links with the two to position to position, they can then change the shapes from, being an arc into a rectangle on back again, or whatever they need to do with the position to position options in there. So that's just a couple of the insert options. I just wanted to run through them quickly. I don't know how many of you used some of those other ones on your projects. So just quickly wanted to go through some of those. The other three, insert absolute, insert intersect, and insert crossfall point, those ones are actually used a lot more in the boxing. So inserting a point, absolutely, whether it's positive or negative from your design layer, left or right from another string, and you basically nominate a base link. Intersecting, where you can nominate different links and find where they would actually intersect in space again, similar to the crossfall option. And the intersect crossfall point, again, inserting a new point given the crossfall and the point location. And as I said, most of those are used in the boxing commands. They are in the insert because they are creating new strings, but they all have in common that they basically have, at the moment, you'll see all the modifiers that I'm using have got the design layer in there by default, which basically is referring to it's going to use the design surface or the road surface strings. That's where but if you just place a new name in there, and you'll see later when Joel does his presentation, he won't have the word design there. Some of the 12D snippets have the word pavement in there, or 12D construction if they're just construction strings. So in version 11, the layers went in there. Sometimes the layers can be invisible, which sort of is a bit of a trick you can play on your AutoCAD friends to say that, 12D's got layers, but you won't see them. Go work that out. But we can have as many layers as you need to. The middle parts of the panel will change and vary depending on what command you're going to run. And then essentially the changes are down the bottom of where the modifications are going to happen. So you'll notice the panels are all set up, structured exactly the same way when they come up. The programmers have done that very deliberately so that it makes it easier again for you guys and new users to work your way through how the panels are supposed to be used. So I wanted to go in and look at some of the other modify to groups. We looked at the to a string, that one's used quite a bit, so I didn't want to cover that one again, and the modify from. So this one actually did step right back and design some basins, three different methods essentially. It's running. And the first basin up the top there, I've actually gone right back and used the apply template. Again, I'm not sure how many people use that, but it does work, but it is very simplistic that it only allows you to run one template on the left or the right, but that's essentially what I've done. Just got a very simple template to do the external side of the basin. And on the inside of the basin, I've decided to run the standard interface command, obviously just battering down to the survey triangulation. Again, they're commands that have been in there forever. They are pretty basic, but I just thought we'd again showcase them just so people know that they're there, how they work. The interface command, or the function itself, and you can see it's just got the cut fill slopes in there, already preloaded in there, and basically just battering down at the slopes nominated down to the survey tin. Now normally when you open up the interface function, you'll notice that we've got those loops being produced, or the strings are crossing over each other. Typically when you do open up the design apply interface option, that loop removal button down the bottom is actually ticked on by default. So I've actually turned it off for this example just to show you, well, the loops that you don't really want in your design, but hopefully the straight interface will take care of it. You will have to be a little bit careful about where the start changes for your super alignment is, because you need the start or the string that you want to produce at the end of the day to be in the good half of the loop. If you change zeros down there and it's in the bad half of the loop, then you might actually end up keeping the bad half of the loop and not maintaining the good half of the loop, if that makes sense. So sometimes you will have to change the parts around your super alignment so it starts correctly in the right order. So I just wanted to go back through that and show you that it's there. It happens for you automatically and those loops get removed, and how to do that also in the MTF file. The second basin, I sort of decided to set it up a little bit different in that I created a false plane, just put a super alignment string in there and just graded that string so that it had a fall across the bottom of the basin. So I've just made it a string up there, a super alignment, graded it, and then triangulated that up. And the idea then is when we come in to do our design, that we can then tell 12D to go down and search for the height of that tin, and go to that tin is the option, and batter down so that it actually finds that. It's sort of used a lot in sewer treatment plants and things, or basins where you want to control exactly where the low point of the basin needs to be. So the outside is pretty simple. It's just running a template to create a bit of a bench and battering down. And on the right side where I've got the modifier, again, I've just inserted one string. The template, I'm going to open it up just to show you what's in the template, because it is a very simple template. It's essentially just got one link. It's just got a string called bottom of bank, BB string. It's just got a width. I didn't really know how wide the string needed to be, but the slope, the crossfall was really important, that I wanted that 1 in 4 slope to be there. So what we're going to do now is look at the modifier to a tin, where I'm basically going to tell 12D to get that bottom of bank link, the string itself, the BB string. I'm just going through here, fixed, modifier to and to a tin. So that's where the option is in the list. And basically told 12D, look, I want the bottom of bank string to go down and find this false floor, the basin floor there, which has obviously got the slope on it that I want, and I've controlled where the low point was. And you can see there, I'm changing the width, but I'm holding the crossfall. So yes, as the string's produced, it will maintain the 1 in 4, and it'll go down and find where that false plane is, but I have definitely controlled the slope down the interface there on the inside of the basin. So again, it's just a bit of a technique of how to do that. And it's just a different way to use the same sort of modifiers. All right. Let that catch up. I'm obviously talking way too quick. Third basin, again, decided to do this a little bit differently. Well, again, on the outside, it's still the straight, very simple template. Nothing's super complicated there, but on the inside, essentially, again, I've inserted the same template, but this time, instead of modifying to a tin, I've decided to use the other modify to option, which is to an RL. Again, the drainage guys like this to create their basin because they can just essentially say, look, I want the floor of the basin to be. Sorry, modify to an RL. There it is in the list. And they can basically just pick the RL. They want the basin floor. Obviously, it's going to be a flat floor in that case. But they can quickly run it and calculate essentially what the storage calculation for the basin needs to be. So by running that, I'm going to tell the BB string, again, going to change the width but hold the slope. So it slopes down on the inside until it hits the RL that I've nominated. And if I need more storage, I can obviously just quickly change the 17 to 16.5, or if I need less, then I can move the height RL up and I can quickly calculate that. So basically I'm holding the crossfall there and the width, I did start with a meter width, but it's obviously needed to get wider to go down to that RL. And why I showed you the original interface option is because, again, we're faced with those crossing links or the loops in our bottom of bank string where they've crossed over. And again, to remove those, you can go under the main menu for the more. And in the menu in the MTF files, you can remove the loops there. So there's an option in there, and that's how we can remove those strings if they're crossing over and removing the loops. You just need to place the string name in the panel there, and you can obviously place multiple string names in there and a wild character. But if you wanted to get, if you wanted to take care of all the loops, you can see the loops are all been removed now, but if you wanted to get rid of all the loops, you could actually, if any of the strings were to cross over, you could actually just place a star in there. So if any of the strings cross over at all, ever, then they'll basically just be removed and those loops will disappear and you could save that in there as well. It just takes care of any of the loops. All right, so we had a look at a couple more of them. I wanted to move on to a couple more in the list there, which is by two strings or from a link. Again, these commands have been in there forever inside 12D, but I'm not sure how many people have used them. By two strings, again, I've used them on another one of the roads over here, but I've set this little road up more like an existing road or what a local government council or if you're redesigning a road on top might have to do, where you've actually given the strings like a centre line, an edge of pavement on the left and an edge of pavement on the right from the surveyor, and essentially you're trying to do a reconditioning. We're just going to mill off the top 50 mil of asphalt and relay the existing road over the top, and that's where these commands, the by two strings or from a link, could come in handy for you. So just open up the MTF file for this road here. That's what I mean. The design, this job's a bit all over the place. This time I've actually used snippets to place the strings in there, just some of the snippets that come from 12D, inserting the curb and gutter and also doing the verge. But really it's the modifying to the two strings that I wanted to look at. So a quick cross-section, you can see the white tin there is the existing, and there's my CAD centre line or what I'd get from the surveyor possibly, and the edge of pavement on the left, which is, again, come from the survey. And my design's in the red over the top, and that's obviously got the exact road width that I wanted, 3.5 and the 3%. But I want 12D to basically go and match the existing crossfall of the existing road. So that's where this one by two strings comes in. So I get my link, my curb lip line, that's the one that's formed the width of the pavement there. And I'm going to get 12D to search for those two selected strings that have come from the survey or the construction ones that I've drawn there, existing centre line and existing lip line. And I basically told D to look, go and find those ones. I do tend to work from the centre line out, just because that's basically a lot of 12D works better that way, if you can set your modifiers up to work that way. And you can see there with the string number one, the side to search, I've set it to search for both sides. Because your design might go down over the top of the existing survey, and sometimes the existing survey might be a little bit on the left, and sometimes it might be a little bit on the right. So I need the 12D to search for that string, possibly both sides of the superalignment, where the edge of the pavement string is definitely on the lip. And you can see there, once I've run that modifier, 12D's gone and measured the crossfall. It's held the width of my road, but it's measured the crossfall, and it's whatever the crossfall was, it's basically then applied that to my design. So every cross-section as I've moved forward, and come down. It's going to go and measure the existing crosswall of the road and then apply it to my design. And I've basically, that way I've got a match over the top of exactly what I wanted to have of the 50 mil, or if you're just trying to match exactly what the crosswall is. So that's by two strings where you can measure either the crosswall, the height, or the width of two existing strings. And basically 12D will measure the current answer at that cross section and then apply it to your string or your link. So that's that one there. Obviously you can see the next one down, I'm gonna go and modify the width as well, so you can get it to match not only the crosswall, but also the width. The right side, I did the same thing in terms of I set it up to go and find the two links, the center line and the edge of pavement on the right. And again, you can see side one to search, I've searched both sides, because again, it could be on the left side of your center line or your right, wherever the existing center line is. So I wanted to run that again, and you'll see the crosswall change. And I wanted to come back to my favorite one, which is the modifier link. I did say that's probably the modifier out of all of them. We trained that one pretty well straight away because it is used the most, the modifier link. It's right at the very top there. Because obviously, usually it overrides the original values that are in the template. So if you're trying to change a crosswall or change a width, you can basically type in the new answer and you'll get exactly what you want. What you want, it'll just override the answers. But there's also a new value usage that's in the middle here where you can actually add to, or obviously in my case, I'm removing a width of half a metre. So this one I actually put a cutback line in. So again, it's pretty common for local councils to want to put a saw cut line or a cutback line in so many metres, half a metre or 300 mils in from the existing edge, and they'll saw cut down there and replace the curb and gutter. So again, it's just a way where you can get the saw cut line to match up where the existing edge of the pavement is, maybe first, like a tour string. And then you can actually remove the half a metre or the 300 mils that you need. And it'll actually step that string in, the saw cut line, to be exactly the width that you want to come back in. So I just wanted to show you that you could add or subtract, obviously, cross falls or widths or heights to answers as well, using that method as well. So yeah, I'm not sure how many people know that's in there. It's just a quick blue drop-down arrow and you can change that to use it completely differently. The from a link, bit of an unusual one. Don't know that I've actually ever used it on a project, but I have to show you because it's in the list like all the other modifiers. Maybe you can come up with a good reason why you'd want to use this one. But essentially, I'm going to measure where my curb lip line is there and get 12D to measure what the current crosswall is. Because you can see the crosswall out of the template at the moment is still the standard 3%. But when 12D's measured the existing road, it was 3.3 at that cross section. So the from a link option is basically to get this string or this link here to go and match another link's answer. In this case, I'm measuring the crosswall, but it could also be the height or the width. So it's essentially taking one answer off your design and moving that answer, either width, height, or crosswall, again to another part of your template or another part of your design. I keep saying template, but it could be a snippet. It's just another part of your strings. So you can see there, now the two cross sections are exactly the same, -3.66. It's just apply that answer from the cutback line across onto the curb lip line there. As I said, it could be used, again, quite useful if you're doing like multiple lanes. Possibly you just have to change one and do super elevation on one lane, and you could say, look, all those other links have to apply back to the first cross section, crossfall answer that I got. But you could do things like this and actually get it to find the cross section off the footpath, which is a bit weird, but you could actually take the crossfall from the verge area up here and then apply it back to your pavement. I don't know why you'd want to do that. That'd be a bit weird. The drainage guys wouldn't be happy. But you can do it. You can basically take those answers from wherever you need them to be. So again, I just wanted to show you the from a link. I don't know that I would have done that. I probably, where I originally went, take the modifier by two strings, are probably back here, I probably would have put the two links in there because you can do multiple links in the same modifier. Whew, talking quick. So we've done a couple there. There's still a couple to go. I wanted to move on to the parallel strings and then the two heights and obviously the absolute as well. They are broken up into the two groups because modifier two usually means that the answer, or you're modifying to something external, like to a string, to a tin, to two strings that are obviously external strings as well, where the modify from are usually things from your own design, like from your own link or from your own base point where the absolute part comes in. So we'll kick into this bit. Again, I've gone over here, I've got a little bus bay. I've created a super alignment where I wanted the bus bay to be, and essentially everyone should be pretty familiar or happy with using the modify to a string, where you basically come up to my curb lip line to go and find this constructed bus bay string that I've produced in there. And it's pretty straightforward. Yeah, 1 meter interval. So you can see the little one there. I'm going to create a lot more cross sections during the position here between the start and end changes there that I've locked in there. Modified to the start and end of that string. And so I've got a lot more cross sections. But the one I wanted to show you was the parallel to a string or parallel from a link. And it came up from the users with feedback that often they'd go in and they'd start to measure the footpath. And out of the standard snippet or standard template, that the width of the footpath would be 1.5, which was what was on the standard details. But when you start to get into the tapered areas of the design, then 12D wasn't perpendicular to the centre line, it still had 1.5. But parallel between the strings, you were losing a couple of millimetres, 13, 14, 15 millimetres between the two. What's a couple of millimetres between friends? Yeah. And the surveyors aren't here, they'll just set it out anyway. Doesn't really matter. So anyway, you designers were complaining that this wasn't good enough, so the programmers went in there and said, okay, well, we'll go parallel to the string. Or there is another option that if you don't have a string there, you could actually go parallel from the link. And essentially what it means is all the other strings in terms of their widths will get generated perpendicular from that string or from that link. So this other one that I designed earlier, that didn't go to another string. I just put those tapers in manually with width modifiers. So I'd actually have to go parallel to the link because I'd actually want it to come off that lip line there and go perpendicular to that link. It being as part of my design. Because I've put this CAD construction string in there, I can actually go, yes, I can go parallel to this string and tell 12D. The cross sections essentially will then come out, hit the string and go perpendicular or at right angles to the string. So I'll gain back those couple of millimetres. You can see it gets a lot more cross sections at the start and the end because it's having to try and find out exactly where that change point is. And obviously, depending on what the angle of the taper is, yes, you can get some pretty strange answers, but it will go at right angles or normal to the string. So I'm just going to quickly go and measure between those two. Yeah, where it was good before 1.5, and you can see as I go through there, it's now maintaining that 1.5, even though it's not perpendicular to the centre line. But then when you get to your cross-section drawings and you go and lay out all your drawings, you find that, yes, the cross-section drawings have, you know, 1.5 and the extra 15 mils. And then the project manager goes, why isn't the footpath 1.5 anymore? So people started to turn that modifier off. So people asked for it, they put it in, and then people went, actually, that's just too confusing, and they've stopped using it, I found. So, but it's in there if you want to use it, 100%. Anyone use it? Yeah, a couple, of course. A couple of people, yeah. All right, going around the corner here, I just basically inserted another template. Obviously, the inserting a full template will produce all the fixed, the cut, fill, and the final battering, but you can also just insert a part of your template. When I've just got a little road drainage, you know, basically just got an open swale here with a couple of strings in there. And I'm gonna insert this into my design itself. So around the corner here, I just thought I'd place this in there first, and then I can drain this swale as I need to produce it. So essentially the DF string, or the front of the swale, is the one I'll be going to edit, but essentially I've just placed another template inside the other design, so it's just produced a whole bunch of links, and this is just a quick long section of what that DF string, or the bottom of the swale, currently looks like. So just trying to position all the views so you can get a better look at that. Right. So basically I wanted to come in and show you, again, this tool was put in there, so that vertical of the swale at the moment is just following essentially the geometric vertical design of the road. So yeah, with the sag in it, they're just the vertical design that's coming from the centre line itself. But given this fixed by two heights, again, I hope some of you have used it because it's a pretty good tool. It's under design modifier two and using the two heights. And essentially you get to nominate what those two heights are. And it was put in to do things like what I'm doing, like modeling swales, And basically just making the strings, the top of benches and things like that, just making them do whatever you want them to do. So essentially here, I've got the option there. I just want that string. I don't really care what the levels are at the moment, but I actually want it to go to an RL of 17.5. And as soon as I lock that in and apply it, you'll see that the strings just becomes dead flat at the RL that I've nominated in there. So yeah, it's basically going to be independently graded from whatever the center line was, and then you can start to modify it up as you need to. I've also setting it so that the height gets modified, but the crossfall gets held, so that you'll notice in plan that it's actually pushed out a little bit from the road. So as it's gotten deeper, it actually continues on that slope down the batter and continues out. But there are a lot of other options in here where you can actually set two RLs. So you can actually model it so that the string drains up the hill if you want to. Even though the road's grading down, you can actually get this string to grade up and do something completely different to what the road's doing. And just by changing the numbers there, it's pretty easy to run again. And you get a linear change in grade over the length of the string. So the programmers just work out the length of the string. I hate to think of the maths in the background that he's doing, because he's not only making it, he's obviously getting longer as it goes as well, because it's pushing it out further. So he's doing the length and the grade and the crossfall at the same time. But the one that I really like is some of these options down the bottom. You get to start to play with these, where you can actually start to lock in grades yourself. And this is where the drainage guys get a little bit excited. Where you can actually keep the original position. The little short pause there is for the original position. And if you remember when I first ran it, it had the vertical profile of what the center line was. And you might actually be happy where it's starting there at the position, and you just want to grade it forward. So you want to grade it out to a low point going forward, even though the road starts to curve back up. I just want to keep grading that down. So for the swale itself, I could come in and go pause and grade it with the forward arrow. And obviously you can grade it back the other way if you needed to, but I can grade it down at 0.5%, lock that in, and you can see that the swale then just grades down at exactly the 0.5% that I want, even though the road was, again, in a bit of a sag there. So I take care of my low point, and I push the low point to exactly where I want it to be. So those positions, they're really great and really handy to use, because you get to choose where it currently is and then just push grades forwards and backwards as you need to. So that was the two heights. And I'm just going to go in and show you the absolute one now. This is the boss one, I always think. This is where you are the boss, and essentially you absolutely want to lock something in, and it will just do what you want it to do. So I thought to show this one. I'd get the footpath up around the corner here. The footpath's on a bit of an arc. And essentially I've just used, again, this modifier link. One of the other types in there is we can set it to go pause to pause and just do a straight line. So even though the road's got a curve in it, I'm not happy with that. I just want it to go make it a dead straight line. No one likes walking around corners, I know that. So we'll just make the footpath go straight and let's set that in there. But obviously that then affects all the other strings that get created after that. The boundary line and the interface string have all moved, not into a position that you want really. You're not really happy with that. And so that's where this modify absolute command comes in. How am I going for time?
36.
Good. So absolute, essentially the link, that's the edge of the verge that I'm going to modify. Again, that's the string I'm going to change or modify. And I'm set up this base link. And again, everyone's got this base link called hinge. It's basically a copy of your center line, and it's hidden in the back of the MTF file. Don't change the name. You can actually change the name there, but don't ring me for support if you change the name, because it'll be too hard for me to work out what you've done. So it's done automatically, and it's just called hinge. It's a copy of your center line. And essentially what I can then do is tell 12DD, look, I'm gonna go and measure currently what the width is between the center line. I could have done it from the lip line as well. You know, from this point where it's good, from the center line there, out to the existing boundary. That was obviously what I had in the original snippet. That's good, that's the width that I want. I don't know where the extra 30 mil came from, but okay. And then essentially I can say, just force it. I just want that width to happen and don't mess with me. And this is basically pull the string back into where it needs to be. So the absolute, again, it means that you can actually have strings on the inside move basically horizontally and vertically and still lock a string on the outside to be fixed in place. Absolutely be in this position and don't mess with you, because you know what the answer is in terms of the height, width or crossfall that it needed to be at. So yeah, it's the absolute command. So that's a pretty handy one. And again, it's used for backer driveways and things like that when you're trying to pull the driveways back into place or the boundary lines back into exactly where you need them to go. So that's a couple more of them. Quickly go through the removes, don't want to spend too much time on them, and the rename. So there's again a couple of different options in there for removing and then renaming, removing, yeah. So there's a remove, which will obviously remove one or multiple links, and you can remove multiple just by, you can see there's a little S in the brackets and the little star there. You can put multiple link names in there. There's also removed only named. They're so similar. They do basically remove links will remove the links from the fixed part. The removed by name will remove parts from the link. Yeah, they're very close. The only difference with this one is it'll also remove the cut, fill, and the final interface as well. So that's the subtle difference between those two. But you can see how I've got multiple links loaded into that one. Again, we're back a couple of versions. The program is put in there to remove multiple links by a number, where you could actually come into, again, I'm just using a template because it's easier to explain it, but the snippet works exactly the same way. You essentially tell 12D the number of links over here that you wish to remove out of the layer. And essentially for the six, it would count from the outside back towards the center line and give you exactly what you wanted so that the lip of the curb, the carriageway edge there carries through the intersection. And that worked completely fine until people decided that they didn't want a footpath in that road today. And so the number changed from 6 to 4 or went from 4 to 6. And obviously then that was a bit of a problem. So the programs went away and then went, okay, well, let's go a different way. Why don't we make the number -2? And so instead of working from a positive number works from the bottom, a negative number actually works from the top down. Who would have ever thought to put a negative in there? Only a programmer. So yeah, it'll keep the number of links that you want. But then again, we get into the situation where today you've got one lane, but tomorrow you might have two. So then obviously -2 might need to be -3. So people weren't happy with that option either. It's all your fault, you guys. There's so many options there because people keep wanting different things. This is all good. But they're all slightly different. They all have their own little niches for where they're needed. So that's what that one does. Again, it gives you exactly what you need it to do. Works perfectly fine. But it was sort of replaced, and the one we do train a lot now is the remove only from the name. And this one's sort of, yeah, under remove here, remove from the name, because we actually get to lock the string name in itself. So by locking in the carriageway edge or the lip of the curb lip line string name, it will just essentially maintain that, and everything outside of that is set to yes to be basically removed or deleted. So and that one doesn't really matter how many links there are, whether it's before or after, it doesn't matter. It's just related on that string name, and everything else just gets taken away and removed pretty easily. So that's that one. I wasn't going to show you the remove, just the simple one where you can actually put multiple links in there, but also needed to show you the difference. Yeah, move, remove, and remove absolute, what this one will do for you. Absolute, again, means that you're boss and it'll do exactly what you want it to do. So normally when you remove strings, like the footpath here, the footpath at the front, the footpath at the back, it definitely takes those strings out, as you can see, but the boundary line moves in and obviously the interfacing moves in and not exactly the answer we're after. So we could go back and use the absolute command and push it back out to where we want the width to be and the height to be. And that's definitely a way to do it. But it's removed those two links and everything else is then shuffled in, essentially closer to the center line, not really what the plan was. So there's also the remove absolute. It does the same thing. It'll remove the two strings, but being the boss, when we calculate and run this one, it'll maintain the absolute position of where that string was last time. So horizontally and vertically, it'll stay in its absolute position of where it was prior to the removals. So again, that's another one that's in there. It might be useful for part of your design also. Rename. Did anyone use the rename strings? A couple of people? Yeah, same people, I see, yeah. Renaming, you can see it's further down the list in the fixed list of modifiers, and it is suggested that you do this towards the end of your MTF file. Towards the bottom, all it will do is essentially between the change denominator, it will change the name of the string, rename it for you. And obviously having a new link name in there, a new string name running it through the matte file can then apply different line styles and make it look pretty. So essentially the command for me makes things look pretty. It doesn't change the design at all, just changes the string type and the name of the string to make it look pretty for your CAD presentation. Having the curb lip line then split into two could form problems later on if you wanted to try and do other modifiers though. So we do suggest that you do any of that sort of prettiness up right at the very bottom of the MTF file for the left and the right sides, and that basically will take care of any problems that the renaming of the string could create for you. So just do it towards the end. So we've had a look at quite a number of these. There's a lot of modifiers in there. Thanks for your time. I'm going to hand it over to Joel, and if we've got any time at the end, I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
All right, we're going to jump into looking at decisions and a bit on snippets. I found over the years people have a love-hate relationship with decisions. You either love them or you just loathe them. So hopefully we'll sort of alleviate some of that fear over the next 10, 15 minutes. So what is a decision? Apparently that's how you pronounce it. It's a noun, it's a conclusion or resolution, it's a process of deciding something or resolving a question, it's making decisions. What's a decision in 12D model? Well, we allow 12D model to make conclusions and we give it a set of rules which generally they're true or false. They're as simple as that most of it. So something's either true or something's false, and that's what the guts of it is. We can test whether above or below a 10, we can keep looping. You know, we can keep looping through if it's doing something like benching. So a typical scenario you come across, you got a deep cut. You might want to put a near vertical batter in to a couple of meters below the surface, and then you want to, you know, batter it out at 1:1. How do you do it? You can do a cut table, you can use multiple templates. It's all clunky and you're going back and forth and never comes out right. You've probably seen decision tables. They've been in version 6, version 5, I don't know. They came in a long, long time ago. Been in there for a long time. It's essentially that you got true, you got false, you go back and forth. You move around the table based on whether it's a true or a false. But even with all that power, they're a little bit limited because decisions were always processed after the fixed modifiers, and it's very hard to modify a link created by a decision table. So the thing was, you know, could decision tables be better? Well, yes, but they had to change. Something had to change. So thankfully, they came up with this idea, let's put decisions in the fixed modifiers. Fantastic, because the decisions are processed with the fixed modifiers. You get more power, you got all your fixed commands that you can use with the decisions, and links created by the decisions can be modified later. Thank you, Mick Guntner, for that. And fixed decisions can be used in snippets. But we'll come back to that a little bit later. So decisions, they fall into three broad categories. You're testing for a result. Am I above a 10? Am I below the 10? Will my batter intersect with the 10 or not? You provide flow control, you know, go to and label. You know, if it's true, go to here. If it's false, go to here. And you can create a link. You can create a batter. Now, you can see here on the right are our old rules from the decision tables. A lot of them are gone now, fixed slope, tin width, because they're modifiers, fixed modifiers. The undo, continue, cut, fill, end, we don't need them anymore. Some of them are stayed, your tin decision, batter decision. You can still create a batter, your labels, your go-tos, and your comments and regions. So we're going to look at a few today. One of the most common ones you'll see is the tin decision. And it's basically you're testing, am I above or below a tin? So typically, to test if you're in cut, you'll have a minimum depth of 0, which is basically where the link is, and you'll go to a maximum depth of 1,000. So if we look over here, we've got our edge of verge link here. We're going to test from 0 to 1,000. If the tin falls within that range, we're in cut. If we test from 0 to minus 1,000, the tin falls in that range, we're in fill. You can also test for shallow cuts and deep cuts and all that. So if we had another one here testing 0 to 5 for a shallow cut, that'd be false because the tin's not there. If we test from 5 to 1,000, it'd be true. So we know we're in a deep cut. The other ones you'll come across a lot are go-tos and labels. So a go-to is, you know, sending processing to somewhere else, going to another command. Often you'll have a label because, you know, a go-to needs somewhere to actually go. The other one we'll look at is polygon. So essentially you might use this where you're doing subdivisions and your batters are starting to encroach inside the property boundaries, which developers tend not to like. So you can test whether your interface string is actually going inside the property boundary and then you can do something about it. The other one to look at is testing above link height. This came about, it was a bit of a special situation where you've got split level carriageways and you're going up and down like this and you want to test which carriageway is up higher, which one's lower, because I've got to put a jersey curb on top of it, stop cars falling over the side. So we can test that, and you can also add in values here. So you can actually see here, this EV link, we're testing whether it's more than 2 meters above our interface. So in this case it's true, we're more than 2 meters above. In this situation here, it'll be false because we're less than 2 meters above that interface. So I'll have a look at how that can be used as well. So let's quickly jump in. And we go. Get rid of these two for a second. So what we've got here is a typical road. We've got a cutting coming through here. That's right. Got a cutting coming through here, and what we want to do is when we get into a deeper than a meter cut, we just want to put a little dish drain in here to catch any water coming down the batter. So we've been a bit lazy today, you don't have to watch me typing, I've pre-prepared everything for you. And the first line in here is our tin decision. So you can see what we're actually doing is we're going from a minimum depth of 1 meter down to 1,000. So if we're less than a meter deep, we don't really care. We don't want to put that drain in. Turn that on, and of course, you notice down the bottom, there's a go-to. There's something that all decisions will have as a go-to, because you've got to test whether it's true or false. If it's false, if I'm less than a meter in cut, then I don't want to do anything, so it's false, and I just want to go down to the end where I've got my label down here. So I'll turn that one on. So at the moment, if I run that, it's not actually going to do anything. It's just going to reproduce the road. So what we're going to do here, we've got our three links just to put our drain in. That's just a typical drain. We're going to offset it 450 mil. We're going to put in our invert and our backer drain. So we'll run that. And if we skip along a bit, so you can see our drain is starting to come in there. Now the problem is we've inserted it before this backer footway here, so still footway's pushing out. So at the same time, we can actually just reduce the width of our footway down to zero. Simple as that. We're in more than a meter cut. We'll get our little dish drain in there. As we come back, the dish drain drops off. So very, very simple decision, that one. Just am I above or below the tin, put a dish drain in, reduce the width. And you can see there, a couple of decision modifiers, and we're just using normal fixed commands in here to do something. The other one we got is we want to test whether we're inside our property boundary. So you can see we've got this yellow polygon around here, and our interface is going inside the property boundary. Bring that up. I've created a bit of a chainage alias to make things easier because I only want to do it through here. And this one's just a polygon. So we're just testing. This is our polygon, our cadastral polygon there that we're testing. It's got some dodgy Z values on it. The string we're testing is our interface string out here. We want to test whether we're inside. So again, if we're not inside, we don't want to do anything and we'll just go down to the end. So we can turn that one on. And we'll turn our end on. And we'll go through here. So what we're going to do here is modify all to string. So if we're inside this polygon, we're actually going to modify and pull that interface back. And we're going to hold the crossfall. We're just going to change the width. A bit hard to see, but we'll zoom in a bit. So it's sitting right on top of it now. Now we know that if we're pulling our interface back, we're obviously going to be sticking up in the air. So we're going to pull it back a bit further. So we're going to reduce the width again by another 400 mil, which is going to allow us to put a bit of a wall in there. So you can see now we've got our boundary in yellow and we've got our interface in red. And what we're going to do after that is just stick in a simple concrete wall. I'll turn those on. Bit hard to see on there, but what we shall do is our nice pretty perspective view. So there's our wall. Yep. And we're actually interfacing that wall back down. Now, something Rod touched on before was some of the 2RL modifiers. Now, this wall is going to look a bit ugly at the moment because it's just, you know, following the basically the ground surface. So we'll come down here. Now, keeping in mind, those links were created as part of the decision process. Outside of our decisions, we can now modify these. We've got a simple, you know, to turn into a noise wall, we just want part of it to be RL37. So we apply that. So it jump up. And we can do the rest of them here too. So we can turn these on. We're just doing this one, we've got an alias, we're starting at the end of that, we're just relative to self-start, so it'll be 25 meters long. And our last one for another 25 meters. So we've got a nice stepped, you know, nice stepped noise wall down the side of the road. So, you know, that's something that we couldn't have done before in the old decision tables. We couldn't have come back and modified those links. Well, we could have, but it'd be, you know, pain in the, you know what. Now, the other one we've got is, which one do I want, this one here. So we're going to test, we're going to be in fill. So we're in fill here, and we want to put a little bit of a catch drain down the bottom, yeah? Now, obviously, we don't want our catch drain to be running around where we're in cut, so what we're actually going to do is test where our edge of verge string is actually above. So we got our EV link up here, we got our interface down here, and we only want to put the drain in where we're higher than, where our embankment's higher than 2 meters. So turn him on. Turn him on. And we're gonna stick our drain in. Oops. There we go, and there's our drain. Now, the other thing we want to look at, we're going to create a little bund on this drain as well. So grab one of these sections. So at the moment, here's our drain down here. It's not really interfacing. So we're going to, you know, link it back to the tin. Now, an interesting one here, if we don't use any stripping, actually turn that on. So we're just interfacing back to the tin. Now, I don't know if anyone or many people realize, normally you put stripping in as positive because 12D knows you're stripping and going down. If you put in a negative strip, it actually goes up. So it raises it above the tin. So what we can actually do is we can create our catch drain and we can create a bit of a bund across the top here. So turn these ones on, create the back of the bund. And there's our bund. That's easy adjusted. We can come back and we go, okay, we only need, you know, half a meter now. Apply that. And we get that automatic bund there. So instead of having to create a link here and another link coming off it, we can just push that up above the tin. So that's, you know, nice little trick. Negative stripping. Positive stripping goes down, negative stripping goes up. So that's those three commands there. So decision tin, decision polygon, and above link height. The tin, I'd say the tin and the above link height are the ones you'll use quite often. At the moment, we've looked at some decisions, so I want to digress for a little bit and talk about BSPs. There's a little name I came up with, some of the panels in 12D. Big, scary panels, and we've got them. There's the network editor, the 2D, 3D helmet overlay design, any plot parameter file. It's new users come up and they, what do I do? And of course, the MTF is no exception. Analyze subgrade. Anybody used it? Not too many hands going up. No. Is Mick Gunter in the room? No. Basically, what this does at the moment, it calculates the upper zone of formation. And coming from New South Wales, he set it up to have all the values in there for the RMS R44 spec. So what's an RS, RMS R44 spec. It's the Earthworks specification that the RMS uses. And it's all for defining these values when you're in an embankment, shallow cut, cut fill transition in cut, that type of thing. It's minimum requirements. It's got lots of information like this type of thing. We've got some typical cross sections which show us, you know, what the upper zone of formation is, the pavement depth, the SMZ zones, there's lots of tables, lots of writing and all that type of thing. 12D can calculate this upper zone of formation for you using the analyzed subgrade. So stay with me here. So what does all this mean? Analyzed subgrade creates links. It puts the links on another layer in the MTF. And it represents the upper zone of formation. So what can we do with those links? Well, we've got a decision that we can use with them. So we can use the analyzed subgrade to tell us where we're in embankment, in cut fill transition. Then we can apply pavements based on the location of those links. So we're getting there. So you can do something like this. You can see we're coming off an embankment, we've got our cut fill transition, and then we're coming into cut. It's just magic. So the command we use for this is link exists. So we're going to test whether a link exists. So in this example here, we're testing where we're embankment. When we're embankment, we want to do something. So we're going to come over. We're using our other side of our road here. And we're going to grab some sections. There we go. So we're up in embankment. So basically what we're doing, we're using multiple commands in here. Where am I? Right side. So it all looks a little bit scary, but basically what we've got up here, we've got our design. We're putting in a couple of temporary strings for us. So you can see they're on a layer. I've just called it 12D temp. You can see in here, as Rod mentioned before, layers, we've got design, we've got curb type, 12D temp, we've got subgrade. I've stuck them on a layer called temp because I'm not outputting them to a model. They're just going to exist in memory, just in the ether for us to use. I'm inserting it from the hinge. So, and I'm inserting another one just under my edge of carriageway line. And here's the analyzed subgrade. So the reason I've created those temporary strings is so that I've got two continuous links running down the length of the road. They're the ones that I'm using to analyze. I want to analyze in those locations. I'm going to create another set of links down here. I'm going to stick them on a layer called subgrade. And basically when that runs, I've got a bunch of decisions in here testing for all the different types of links. So we've got embankment, we've got shallow embankment, embankment to shallow embankment to cut fill. So it creates all these different strings for you. And you'll see some of them, I'm actually sending them to the same location. So shallow embankment to embankment's going to SEM. And embankment to shallow embankment, essentially the same thing, so it's going to the same label. So they will all run, and they'll create a bunch of links for us. And you'll see what we've got down here, if we zoom in a bit. You'll see we've got these links. So we've got a red one, which is where we're in cut. We've got the brown, where we're in the cut fill transition, got the funny off yellow, which is from shallow embankment to the cut fill transition. So it gives you all these actual links that you can use. And we can use them in here. So here's our labels. So from all these decisions up here, we're coming down to these various labels down here. And you'll notice I've got to go to. So once I'm in embankment and I've done my pavement, I don't want to do anything else. So I just want to go down the end. I just want to finish it all and come down here to the end. So we start turning some of these on. And you'll see we're starting to get our pavements. So we'll turn a few more on. And if we go and have a look at this. So you'll see here where it's starting to step up a bit. Let's take a couple of those tins out. saying so there. So quite quickly and quite simply, we've created a bunch of pavements in our design. And so it's, you know, analyze subgrade. Take a look at it. It's a big scary panel, but it makes sense. I'm sure the guys from TMR have got something similar to the R44, so you know, have a chat with them. But it's worth a look at that one. All right. So now that we know decisions and snippets can actually play nice together, we can do lots of stuff. So, what about decisions in snippets? Well, let's take a look. So let's move on to snippets and a bit of other stuff. So a quick recap. A snippet is a collection of MTF modifiers saved to an external file. It allows you to group modifiers together to be a single command. So I think an example we've used before is doing a layback for a driveway. You've got 9 MTF commands per driveway. You can wrap all that up in a snippet and just chuck a bunch of snippets down the road. And they're more flexible than templates. You can enter values on the fly. Templates are quite rigid. You had to modify them by multiple templates. Snippets, you can insert them and modify them on the fly. So by now, most of you should have come across snippets. A lot of you have even had a bit of a crack at making them and just doing simple things like this, putting a road together, that type of thing. You'll have also heard about parameters. These are where you create a parameter for the user to enter a value into the snippet. You got reals, integers, string name, string select, choices, layer name, model name, lots of different ones there. And there's a bunch of auto parameters. So the auto parameters are where the user doesn't have to do anything. They sit in the background and they automatically add values. Most common you'll come across is the auto left right. It'll stick an L or an R based on the end of it. You got your MX style naming, your auto 0i, that type of thing. Start change, end change, all the reference, there's more of them. They just keep putting more and more. I had to update this PowerPoint a couple of days ago because I noticed there's some newer ones in there, which I hadn't had in there before. So, and I think there's more coming in 14. So they're auto parameters. You've probably come across tokens. We've mentioned tokens and if statements. That's all these def tocs and if tocs and if value exists, if value equals, all these types of things. You got else and your end if and your go-tos and your labels, that type of thing. And we know we can do things like this. You know, we can create speed humps and we can do other things like create signs and bus shelters and all that. And that's all done in the MTF using snippets. So how do we create one? Well, as we know, we need the MTF. The simplest way is put all your commands in the MTF and you copy and paste them into a text editor. So you start off, you put your commands in, use the copy, snippet, paste, which we'll show in a minute, paste them into the text editor, and save it with the extension MTF snippet. Done. That's it. And you'll end up with something looking a lot like that. Now, it's a bit locked in. It's not much more than a template at the moment because your values, all these numbers, you hard-coded them into the snippet. So you want to make it a bit simpler, make it a bit more user-friendly, and that's where your parameters and your auto parameters start to come in. So like I said, parameters, you'll make values like the lane width. You'll make that a parameter so the user can change the lane width when he inserts a snippet, or when she inserts a snippet, I should say. Auto parameters are where you've got your left and your right. So looking at this one, obviously these modifiers came from the left side of the road, so we've all got L on the end of the string names. So we don't want that. We want that to automatically be L or R depending what side we insert the snippet. So we mentioned the parameters before, your reals, your integers, your names. So in that one there, what we would have, we would make user parameters for width, crossfall, the path widths, and we would just insert them down in the commands like this. So when they open the snippet, the user can change these values here and they'll pass down into the modifiers. Auto parameters. So again, bunch of auto parameters. They do the work for you. They put the left and the right. They'll put the ref string name. They'll put the model name, the tin name. There's a whole heap of them. The left and the right is the one that you will come across a lot because you'll need it, unless you want all your strings to have the same name on the left and the right side of the road. And so let's go in, we'll quickly create one. So if we come back up to, where's my road going? Just turn on our string names. So we've got the left side of our road here. So we've got a curb and gutter in here. We've got a footpath. We've got a back of footway. So I'll turn off our decisions for a minute. I'll come up here. So essentially, we're going to grab all of these links here. And we want our interface. Notice I'm taking the comments with me as well, because I'll come across. And we go copy snippet paste. So you've got the copy command, but you want copy snippet paste. And that basically just alters the syntax a bit better. Alters it so it actually fits in with the snippet. So we paste that in. We go save as. Deep. And there we go. You'll notice all the colours will change because I'm using TextPad. I've set it up to have the syntax highlighting. Highly recommend Notepad++, TextPad, UltraEdit, whatever. You can all do the syntax highlighting. Makes your life a lot easier to actually read these things. When you'll go through here, so you look at this, we've got a lot of zeros in here. We don't particularly need all them. So what I like to do is a bit of a find and replace and just get rid of all the zeros. All the L's here, we'll come in and we'll change all them to auto LR, which I've spelled wrong. I'm having trouble spelling today. There we go. You know it's right when the colour changes. So we'd come down there, we'd paste all that. We'd come up and we'd insert our parameters and everything. So I'm not going to sit here and type it all up for you. I'll grab the one obviously I've prepared a bit earlier. So you see up the top here, we've got all our parameters. So we're getting parameters for the width of the carriageway, the crossfall. They all come down here. So you got your width, your crossfall. Notice our shoulder is using the same crossfall as the road, obviously. Up here, we've got all our DevTalks. If you have a look in the library, all the snippets that come in the library, we've set them all up basically the same way. We're using a lot of tokens at the top to define default values type of things. Something like a footpath crossfall, you might just always be 2%. So the user doesn't have to put 2% every time. You can just have it as a default value. If it changes on the project you're working on, you can just come in here and edit that. So you only edit it once rather than having to come down here and edit it three times for these modifiers. The other ones have got some display things in here. We're using a optional in here, so I'll have a look at that one a bit more, but we've got parameter in here, which is optional, and we're using that with a couple of if statements down here. So if shoulder has a value, put the shoulder in, else if shoulder doesn't have a value, then don't put it in. So come over to the right-hand side, we turn this on. So you can see here's our parameters, carriageway width, shoulder width. I can actually take that out. And you see it grays out. Typical as normal in 12D when something's optional, it's usually italic and grayed out. We can just apply that. And there we go. And there's our snippet on the other side of the road. Right, so we saw in there we've got some tokens, we've got some if statements. Defining a token is just DevTalk, the token, the name that you want to give it to, and its value. So for example, we had Seaway, and you can do mass in there. So for our full carriageway, might be the width plus the shoulder, and for some reason might want to multiply it by two. So on there we had some default ones. So in the MTF, we had three commands, and they're all using the same crossfall. So define it up the top as a single token, and we can just use that crossfall there. You change that number here, and that automatically passes down to the rest of the modifiers. You saw the if statement in there. So if x equals y, do something, or as you'll often have with optional, we don't always want a shoulder on the road, so we can just have it optional. If shoulder has a value, if someone types a number in there, then it will put the shoulder in. That was all the easy stuff. So thinking back to our decisions a bit earlier, so we're going to put them into the snippet. And again, it's a nice simple one. We grab all of these. copy snippet paste. I want to put them in before the final interface. And we do it like that. Again, you would come through, tidy up all your numbers. Now you notice here that we're using survey, but we've actually got a parameter defined for survey, so you would actually change that to $tin, so the modifier's using the same tin that you've specified up here. I'm not going to go through and type all that out. Got one prepared earlier. And you can see here's all our decisions down here. We've already done the auto left right through there, we've got the tin, we've tidied up this, you know, absolute start end on the end of it type of thing. So that's all tidied up there. So we can actually come back to our right hand side. We can grab our decisions and apply that. If you go down to where we're in cut, you'll see we've got our dish drain in here. Now the problem we've got in our snippet, the width of that DF link, so the width in here, we've got it hard coded in there, we've got an actual 450 in there. And as you can see, if the back of our footway changes, we end up with something a bit odd. We want that to be nice and smooth transition through here. So what can we actually do about that? Well, there's a little thing called variables. And so as I said, DF is a fixed width, but we want it to vary when the width of our footway varies. So what we can actually do is we can define variables in the snippet. And it's a little bit the old, little bit like the old from command, where you're taking a value from another link. So we can do a bit more with it. We can catch a width, height, and crossfall. We can do other things with it. But first thing we're gonna do, we're gonna declare the link we wanna capture. So this is a syntax for it, so we link variable, link name, which in this case will be our EX, and we give it an alias. Once we've done that, we say, what do we want to capture? So there's many options available. You've got height, width, grade, crossfall, offset, absolute offset, X coordinate, Y coordinate, centerline grade, centerline change, name grade, tin height, other tin height, of course. So to capture the link would be variable, we want to give it a new name, so we give the variable a name, and we're capturing the width of our alias. So thirdly, we then need to substitute that variable back into a modifier. So previously where we would have had 0.45 in here, we're actually bringing that variable value in there. So our snippet will actually look like this. We declare the link to capture, which is EX. We give it a name, an alias. We want to capture a variable, so we're going to call it DFWT for width, so DF width, and we want the length width of EX, and then we substitute that into the modifier. Now, one thing to note, we need to capture the length of EX, the width of EX, before we modify it, because if you capture it after you modify it, the width is going to be zero because we've already reduced it down to zero. So you need to do your variables before you actually modify it. So you've got to think about the order you're doing things. But the problem we got now, it just makes the DF link equal to EX, which is kind of going to work, but it's not allowing for the width of the drain, so it's still going to be a little bit wrong. So what we've actually got in our snippet, we've got a couple of tokens for the width of the rest of the drain. We're going to actually create a new one. So we're going to add these together to give us the overall width of the drain. This will all make sense in a minute. And then we subtract that from the width of EX. So what we're actually doing now is our variable for the width here, we're actually taking the width of our EX link and subtracting the width of the drain. And then substituting it back into the modifier. So what that actually means is if we weren't subtracting the width of the drain, we would actually have the EX link coming through and then the drain hanging off the back of it. But we want it all to be nice and smooth. So again, say you're watching me type. So you can see down here, so we're capturing our EX link, we're getting the width of it, and we're subtracting the width of the drain. We're also going to put the value out to a user message so we can actually see what's going on. Now you notice the reason we're capturing it up here is because we've got a command down here, remember, that's changing the width of EX to zero. So if we had that after that command, then we're just going to capture a width of zero, which is going to be useless to us. We want the width of the EX link up at this point here, not down here. We'll come and throw that one in and apply that. And you see now we get EX just continues through as a nice straight. It's basically just making an absolute. We're turning EX into an absolute link. We can change that to whatever we want. And it's always going to be this constant width coming through here. So that's a quick look at variables. There's lots you can do with them, but very good for that. So I think we're nearly there. So what else can we do? Well, we already know that a tri-mesh can be created via a snippet. But did you know tri-meshes can be used in clash detection? And you know, do you need to do clearance checks under, around, over structures, through buildings, that type of thing? Well, something we've been playing with a little while ago was, you know, clearance envelopes, or for railway, kinematic envelopes. So I've got a little job in here. Come on. Now, the beauty of this one, do many people use named grades? A couple of hands going up. And you know, on the insert absolute modifier, you can specify named grades, so you're actually inserting normal to another link rather than vertical. So I've got our rail here, so we travel down a bit. As we get to our curves, we start to get our cant happening. You can see that our whole envelope is actually tilting over. So now this is a very basic one, but it just shows that, you know, you set your snippet up, you use name grades and everything, and it all works nice and neat. If I go and, oops. It's actually got it on our right side here. Not a lot that the user actually does in this one. It's quite basic, but you can see here, I'm just doing a bunch of insert absolutes, so I'm creating a name grade up the top, which is just grabbing my two rail strings, and I'm grabbing them from the left-hand side and the right-hand side. So the joy is, if you're doing a name grade, you can actually grab them from different sides in a snippet, and then I'm just using that name grade in here. So I'm using that name grade in all the insert absolutes, and then creating my shape. So as we travel down the track, yeah, we get the whole envelope tilts over with the rail itself. And you can run that clash detection, you have your bridges and everything coming in, and away you go. So where can I find out some more information? Well, we've got the library. So they've under design, MTF, snippets, edit snippet. You've got library and there's 30, 40 something snippets in there now. In your actual modifiers themselves, so you can bring them in, you know, when you insert a snippet, you can grab them. There's a list of them all down there. The forums, there's a whole section. If you're not on the user forums, you should be on there. There's a whole section on MTF snippets on the user forum. Lots of information. And of course, YouTube, I did a simple search, 12D model snippets, brought up 185 results. So plenty of information out there. Or training. Or come to training, yes. And that's it. Thank you. I think we've gone a little bit over, but if anyone's got any questions, you're free to hang around.